Hi, I'm Victor, and I'm here to talk today about performance in PyTorch. In particular, we'll be talking about how to make performance faster for everyone using PyTorch. Today, we're going to talk about four things. We're going to talk about performance, what it is, what it means, and why it's important. We're going to talk about challenges in improving performance. And we're going to talk about one of our main tools that is new for improving performance for everyone, which is called TorchBench. And we're also going to be talking about how this fits into a larger ecosystem of user-driven benchmarking. Basically, we're looking at performance. Performance isn't about one model, it's about all the models. And we're looking at how to improve performance for the important models that are really popular and every model that everyone is using in their own research use case as well. So we're looking at the whole holistic collection of models that people use on the platform. And we're looking at how to make them all better by making framework level changes. And when we talk about performance, we're not talking about, in this case, accuracy or quality measures. We're talking about performance in terms of system performance. This means doing things like throughput, doing things like efficiency. How can we do the same using less resources and being greener and less carbon emissions? And we're also talking latency. How can we get back to the user faster with an answer and give them a more interactive experience? And we're also talking about things like throughput, where if you have a background job churning through a lot of data, how do we get those bulk collection analysis jobs running efficiently? Performance is a difficult problem, and there are a lot of challenges that come up when we talk about performance. One of those things is understanding what part performance is influenced by the way the user is using the framework, and what part of the performance can come from the framework itself. Because there's some things a framework just can't improve, things like if the disk is too slow to saturate a GPU, there's not a lot PyTorch can do about getting a faster disk in place. But there is a lot of things PyTorch can do on like the fusion levels, on the way we dispatch and order operations, and that can greatly influence performance across a wide variety of users. Another challenge we look at is prioritization. Because there are so many different models, and the popular models change month by month, year by year, understanding how to prioritize what models we're working on and what models need the most performance improvement is a challenging problem. And we'll talk more about how we can do this later. Finally, we also have to talk about the quality of our proxies. This means that if the benchmark gets faster, or if the thing we're using to measure performance is faster, does that mean performance is actually getting faster for our users, for the people who are using PyTorch? And this is a really difficult question to answer, because if you're running a model in isolation on your own system, it's not always obvious if those improvements will translate to the users in their actual environments. So we're going to dig into kind of these challenges and how these can be addressed. Another set of challenges in this space comes from making sure the benchmarks are high quality, as we talked about, good proxies. So certain models like recommenders, for example, the data will influence how memory is accessed during training. Other speech models, for example, may have algorithms that do searches, and depending on the nature of the data, the actual search depth can change from run to run. Also, in measuring performance and understanding performance, noise is a huge factor. For example, if we make a change to PyTorch, and we want to understand, is that change good for PyTorch? Is that improving performance for users, or is it regressing performance for users? Our noise, or basically the variance from run to run of our benchmarks and of our performance measurements, dictates the smallest improvement or regression we can detect. So lowering noise allows us to detect smaller improvements and detect smaller regressions. The other big challenge that we run into when understanding performance is the configuration. You can have the same model, and you can change shapes, and having new shapes in that model can greatly influence the performance and give you an entirely different profile for how the model is performing. So just because you're optimizing, you know, a transformer and you're trying to make PyTorch faster for transformers, for example, that doesn't mean that, you know, because your transformer is getting faster, everyone's is, because people are using different shapes, different sizes, a different number of layers. And so we have to account for all this when improving performance. This is where TorchBench comes in. TorchBench is a new benchmark suite that we're releasing in open source that captures models the way users use them. This means running at the precisions they're using, running on the hardware they're using, and running using configurations that they are using, taking code the way it's written. And this is really important, because if you have a production system created by 100 engineers powering large products, the code will be written in a very different way than if you're a researcher working on a paper. And so TorchBench is focused on the researcher use case, capturing the code the way the researcher would write it, and capturing the hardware they'd be running on, at the precisions they'd be running at. And making sure we have to take a holistic look at both training and inference, including eager and scripted modes. And the idea here is that we want to make sure that we have plenty of models so we don't over-specialize. We're not here to improve one model. We're not here to improve just a single model. We're here to improve everyone's models, which requires a wide diversity of models. And it also means we need to bring together the scores of all these different models to understand the impact across this very large suite. So we have a way to compute a score through geometric meaning, and we have all sorts of different configurations from all sorts of different models written as a researcher would write them. And this gives us the most accurate view possible into if we make a change in PyTorch, how will users actually feel and experience that change in their work, in the workloads they run? So for TorchBench to be successful, as I said before, diversity is key. We want to make sure that we represent models that everyone wants to use. And this is a tricky problem because there are such a large variety of models, and it's not always obvious what's up and coming, what we should be benchmarking, what's important. So we have to be very careful about these decisions. And so the way we're approaching this right now is we take popular, well-known models that we see a lot in the community, and we bring them together. And here you can see a distribution of roughly how these distribute across different workloads and different domain types. Now, don't be alarmed at the proportionality, because as I said before, we have scores that help us normalize. So just because that we're disproportionately representing convolutions in the actual aggregation, because we can rebalance and reweight the scores we're getting from these to proportionally reflect everything evenly instead of based on how many models we have. Now, this also raises the question of how do we select models? What goes into choosing a model, and how do we know which models to use? And this is how it all works together, because anyone can contribute a model, and we don't have to worry about having the right exact proportion of models in the suite. We can take whatever models people care about and then do the rebalancing at the score level. And I'm going to talk more later in more detail about bringing in more new models. This is actually the central element of how to build a strong performance ecosystem. As I said earlier, proxies are critical. We have to know that when we are improving a benchmark, that it's improving the actual user who's using the benchmark, that someone's life is actually getting better. And this is where choosing the right benchmark code is critical. The number one way to know, is it worth improving a benchmark, is to have been given that benchmark by someone who says, this is a workload I care about. I run this every day, or I run workloads like this every day. And they actually give it to us and put it in the hands of PyTorch developers everywhere. As they change PyTorch, they can see if their change is regressing the performance of that model. And they can dig into that model and ask the question, how do we improve our performance here for everyone who runs models like this one? And this is the heart of a good, strong benchmarking ecosystem, where the benchmarks are actually sent in by the users. And so developers don't have to question, you know, is this benchmark real or fake? Is this benchmark important or not? Because you know it's important, because you know someone told you it was important and put it in your hands. And this is our long-term goal for TorchBench. Starting out, we did our best guess at what models are important and what models people care about. Going forward, we want people to actually tell us what they want to see improved and have the benchmarking decisions driven by users and make this direct connection between users and developers for performance. So that way we know that we're actually impacting real people in real workloads and not just synthetic numbers on a dashboard somewhere that we wonder, does anyone actually care about it? So TorchBench is open source and available on GitHub. So if you want to learn more about this, you can go to GitHub, you can download and run TorchBench, and it's completely open source. In your own development, you can use it to do testing and debugging of your changes to understand if you change something in PyTorch, how is it affecting the performance for our users. And if you're a user of PyTorch, if you run PyTorch every day and you care about how fast it can get back to you with an answer, there's a simple way to add new models there. So you can open an issue or open a pull request where you bring in a model, simple interface, or point us at a model, because we'd love to just get pointers to models you care about. And we're happy to help you onboard them. And we can actually bring in these models into TorchBench and start this feedback loop between the users who use PyTorch and the developers who develop PyTorch performance. Thank you.